Our hearts need to cry out. We have family members, friends, even some of us have broken hearts, have lives that are busted up. But yet our hearts won't cry out. But these bones will sing, these dry bones. They're not even singing, much less in service to the Lord. God, what will it take? I pray that you would grip our hearts. God, there are people inside this church that have really caught on. They are really grasping what it takes to serve you, God, to spend time with you, to study your word, to counsel people with wise counsel, to bring light to situations instead of just adding more problems, adding to the pile of gossip, adding to the pile of problems. We can give them hope because all our hope is in you. There is no hope outside of you. God, once we understand that fact, then we'll really have independence. Then we can really celebrate Independence Day, our freedom in Christ. What does it profit to gain all the independence of the whole world and lose our own soul? God, I thank you for your spirit here this morning. I thank you for your presence. Jesus.
We're Proverbs chapter 20 this morning. Adam, come on up here and help me. He's coming under the bottle. And she couldn't get up here at the front. Man, God's just dealing with me in several different manners. Just made a decision just a moment ago. I feel like God wants me to stay where we were headed today. And for those of that are guests, and maybe you missed a few Sundays, whatever, we're dealing with moral deficiencies. Just thinking about some things, some areas in our lives that are struggling. And today, I'm going to be dealing with a topic that over these next few weeks, even topics that are hot topics. They're debatable topics in some's eyes, and even in Christendom, some that have been questioned even in recent days in my life. People want to know about it, this, that, and the other. But I want to deal with the subject this morning. That's why Christians shouldn't drink. And in the midst of July 4th, barbecue, all that kind of stuff, a lot of it goes on. I actually, this morning, this Holy Spirit of God dealing with me, I preached a message Sunday night at the revival about, if we're going to have a revival in America, what's it going to take? And you know that scripture, 2 Chronicles 7:14, that's so significant in our lives. And I want to just tell you on the preface of this message this morning, is my people understanding there that God's talking to Christians. Solomon has rebuilt the temple. He's prayed. And there's some significant things going on there, and God just tells me, if my people would get right, if my people would really seek me, if they'll humble themselves, really humiliate themselves, dwell, pray. When's the last time we really dwelled with God as individuals? When we really sought God, and then we turned from the wickedness. Man, you're in Bible study this morning. I hope you were. Matthew chapter 7, Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, it deals with it down there. Calls us evil people. We don't like that. I told our group, we don't like to be called evil, but he calls us straight up. Jesus calls us evil. And then, so God says if we'll turn from our wickedness, and only when we do all of that, then God says he's going to hear, and God's going to heal. Is there a chance for America? There is. Is there a chance for the world? There is. Is there a chance for you today? There is. Is there a chance for your life? No matter what's going on in your life this morning, there's a chance for you. But it's found in Jesus Christ and him alone. In turning and humbling ourselves, literally turning our lives over to him and being submissive. We don't like that word, but being submissive, being humble, really seeking God. I'm talking about turning from the wickedness. Judgment's going to come on the wickedness. It's going to come. And unless we turn, unless God gives us that opportunity for the great awakening, judgment is going to come. But I'm telling you, part of it is because Christians have sat down, we've taken a back seat, we've participated in things that we knew we shouldn't participate in. participate. We're currently participating in things that we know we shouldn't participate. And then we want the blessings of God. And it simply is not going to happen that way. We got to learn to do it God's way, in God's time, and on God's purposes. And until that happens, then we're not going to see the power, nor the presence, nor the revival of God come in our own personal lives, in His church, or in this nation that we call America. I will say this to you on the front end this morning. Much research has been done, and a lot of what I say today is not your pastor's words. It's from the Scripture, but it's through research. Pastor Johnny Hunt, many others, Adrian Rogers, David Jeremiah, J.D. Greer, a lot of other folks. But it takes a lot of research. Some of you want to write down some stats today, because I'm going to give you some things that I hope will be eye-opening. We've got folks in this building this morning, I don't know who you are, but you know who you are, who are struggling in the areas of drinking. We've got some that are selling their lives out, or we know somebody who's selling their lives out in these deficiencies. And I want you to see what it leads to. I want you to see the fact of what God says in His Word. And I want to try to base it strictly on His Word. Not what man says, but I want you to see it from godly principles, from the Word of God itself. And so when you think about that, it's a big issue. Just had a conversation within the last 2 weeks with a guy who's in church, and he was talking about the fact of drinking, and it's okay to drink, and it's okay to this. And I didn't get in an argument. I just sat there and listened to him and made a few comments and about that. But, you know, I had a church call me the other day. And now, in the midst of churches calling and interviewing from pastors, they have to ask this question, you know, in Southern Baptist Live and other life, whether they're Catholics. And then they say, well, what do they believe about drinking? What do they believe about fornication? What do they believe, you know, are we socially drinking? Are we doing this? That's questions you used to didn't have to ask. Right. But now you're having to ask, because we have pastors that stand in pulpits. We have staff who socially drink. We do all of that. And so now we have those questions. And so I want to deal with that this morning. I want to give you, to start with, Proverbs chapter 20. And we're going to go with one verse there. And then I want you to go to Proverbs 23, give you a couple of verses there. We're going to pray, and then we're going to move on through the message. So I want you to hold tight with me. You don't get it all. If you'll email me or text me something, I'll send you the notes so you can get the stats that I'm going to give you. Because some of it's going to go, I'm going to have to go quick this morning. Wine is a mocker, strong drink is a brawler, and whoever is intoxicated, the word there is led astray. Whoever is led astray by it is not wise. Go over to Psalms 23. Patrick, you texted me this. You didn't know. You and I talked about the sermon, but you didn't know that was going to be in anyway. Take a look at it. Verse 29 and following. Who has woe? Who has sorrow? Who has contentions or strife? Who has complaining? Who has wounds without cause? Who has redness of eyes? Bloodshot eyes is the word there. Those who linger long over wine. Those who go to taste or to test it out, the mixed wine. Do not look on the wine when it is red, when it sparkles in the cup, when it goes down smoothly. And in the end, at last, it bites like a serpent. It stings, it poisons like a viper. Your eyes will see strange things, and your mind will utter perverse or confusing things. And you will be like one who lies down in the middle of the sea, or like one who lies down on the top of the mast, on the rigging. They struck me, but I did not become ill. I'm not hurt. They beat me, but I did not feel it or know it. When shall I awake? So I will seek another drink. Let's pray this morning as we get into the subject. Father, in the name of Jesus this morning, I thank you, Lord, for the research. I thank you, God, for, God, just the challenge of life. I thank you, God, for the Word of God. I thank you for the wisdom and understanding, God. I thank you that, Lord, that you didn't ever let me go down that road. God, I thank you that I didn't get into that point. But God, so many people are. And God, we need to help, and we need to deal, and we need to work through these things. And God, you give us biblical principles to live out our life. And so, God, I pray for help in this. I pray, God, that in the midst of our lives, that, Lord, we would listen, and we would turn from our wickedness. We would seek you and dwell with you, and God, allow you to hear and heal our land. So, God, you bless our time right now. And God, get the glory in Christ's name. Amen. I'm telling you, when you think about it as a pastor, some of you, I hope you wouldn't debate this, but as a pastor or staff, and I want to debate the lives of Christians in general. I want you to invest in lives. That ought to be your goal. Whatever it costs is to invest in lives. Help others make a difference. You make a difference in their life, and then enable them to make a difference in others' lives. That's why I believe we do ministry. I believe that we start and we do missions and we reach out, we do transition ministry, all of that kind of stuff. Folks disagree with it. We want folks that look like us. We want folks that act like us. We want to sit by folks who look and read and do the things that we do. And folks, I'm telling you, we live in a society that desperately needs to see the love of Jesus, that desperately sees the church reaching out and touching in their lives. You know, the thing is that some folks get upset and they get mad at times for the stance that I take or you take. But I'm telling you, what's it boiled down to? It's what the Word of God says this morning. It's about the standard of God. It's not about what you say or I think. It's not about your control or my control. It's about the Word of God. And that's where you and I have got to settle. We've got to settle when He said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, we need to learn how to be humble. We need to learn how to follow the Word of God and find the principles of God and live on those principles of God. And you nor I have a right at any point in time to abuse somebody or to look down on somebody just because of where their life is. What God wants us to do is to minister to them, to speak into their life, to touch their lives for the kingdom of God. And so God calls us to be His hands and to His feet and to be the example that He's called us to be transparent. As a pastor, I'll tell you, I try to be transparent. I try, under God, to model to the life of a believer, the life of a pastor before you. And we all ought to have the model of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's my desire not to have anything that would damage my witness. And that's my prayer for each one of you on a week-to-week basis, that you have not have anything in your life that's going to damage your witness for the kingdom of God. The same is true with me. I know we're going to make mistakes. I know things are going to happen. I talked to you last week about the danger of willfully sinning. If you miss that message, you go online and look at it. Go back to Hebrews chapter 10. Those that know to live right, those that have been saved under Jesus, and you choose to willfully sin, you're on dangerous territory. I dealt with that last week, even to the point that you can lose your life because God may have to take you out prematurely. But it's a dangerous thing for you to know to do what God's called you to do and then turn away from it and live in a way that's totally against God. So it's my desire, and it ought to be your desire, to live our lives in a way that people might see Jesus in us. That's not in an arrogant way. It's not tooting your own horn. It doesn't have your nose up in the air. But I'm telling you, God calls us to live in the way that He wants us to live. It may cause controversy, but I'm telling you, God calls us to live according to the Word of God, to look at the Word of God, to believe in the wisdom of God, and to find out what God has in store for you and I as children of God. And the fact is, when we look at it today, I believe His Word teaches us that we ought to stay away from alcohol, as well as other things that we'll be dealing with over the next few weeks. But at the same time, no one has the right to look down on those who are struggling or being faced with the addiction or the reason, whatever that may be going on in their life, that maybe even somebody interprets the Scripture in a different way. I like what Pastor Josh Franklin, he wrote a book. You know all these ads, and even the other day, we were at the Shuckers game. Talks about the fact of drinking responsibly, or at the end of the Shuckers game, it says that you can call this number and get a ride home. What does it mean about drinking responsibly? You know, the thing is, Josh Franklin says this: alcohol does not send a person to hell. It is not a top-tier doctrine for our faith and practice as believers. He says, I do not look down on those individuals who have taken an honest, non-biased look at the issues surrounding alcohol and hold a different view. The fact is, many feel that this whole alcohol issue inside the church is a matter of Christian freedom and liberty. And you know, the thing, when you look at that, as a pastor, I think when you look at that and you come down on the side of the Lord Jesus Christ, it's your pastor talking, I think as the Word of God, it demonstrates to us, and I hope to demonstrate to you this morning, that we as Christians should not drink alcohol in any form or fashion. So that's a stand that I'm taking for you this morning. Some of you are going to have different stands, but I want to try to give you a basis for that in the Scripture, And I'm not going to look down. I've been in your homes. I've been in people's homes and they're drinking. I choose not to. You do. That's okay. You and I are going to love each other. We're going to keep working right on through. And the fact is, Galatians 5:13 talks about the fact that it says, for you were called to freedom, brethren. And it says, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love, serve one another. I think that's significant right there, that latter part. Don't use your freedom for your own stinking, selfish opportunity, but to think about what God or what other people are looking at you and what they're saying and the fact of the relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. So let's jump in real quick. The battle. Man, there's a battle going on. And dealing with folks that are alcoholics, have been alcoholics, several in our family, different things in ministry, over and over and over again dealing with it. Been with folks laid out in hotel rooms, been with folks that are puking their guts out, all kinds of stuff, all right? But there's a battle that goes on in this industry of drinking. And some of us in this building may be battling that very issue this morning. But I want you to think about it with me. Alcohol companies spend close to $2 billion a year advertising in the U.S. $2 billion. Youth exposure, listen to this, youth exposure rose 38% from 2001 to 2007. By the time a typical teenager is 18 years old, he has seen 100,000 beer commercials. That's from the Center on Alcohol Marketing, Georgetown University. Let's talk about some statistics. This is what I'm talking about. You may not be right fast enough to keep up with me this morning, but you can ask me and I'll get it to you. The median age at which children begin drinking is just over 13 years old. I could probably ask you here how many took their drink less than 16 and a bunch of hands would go up. All right? Over 83%. By the way, I would be in that less than 16 years old. Over 83% of adults who drink had their first drink of alcohol, listen, before age 21. At 4 out of 10 youth, 40% of youth who pick up alcohol before 18 years old become alcoholics. 90% of high school seniors say they've drunk alcohol sometime in their lives. 90%. You listening? 4 million Americans under 18 years of age. 4 million Americans under 18 years of age are alcoholics. 67% of high school seniors used alcohol in the last month. 95% of the 14 million alcoholics today began before the age of 21. When you look at it, continuing, 38% of high school seniors say they've had 5 or more drinks in a row within the last 2 weeks. 36% of American fourth graders, 9 and 10 years old, say they have been pressured by their peers to drink alcohol. 25% of all alcohol consumed in America is by those under the legal drinking age of 21. 25%. Teen drinkers are 7 times more likely to engage in premarital sex. Anybody want to know why? Because it relaxes your morals. I mean, you just build it, not something you wouldn't have done if you had been sober. Think about it. Big time. Teen drinkers 7 times more likely to engage in premarital sex. Relax more. 2/3 of all school assaults and date rapes among teens and college students involves alcohol. Youth who drink alcohol at any level, check this out guys, youth who drink alcohol at any level are 7.5 times more likely to use illicit drugs and 50 times more likely to use cocaine than a young person who never drinks alcohol. It's a wisdom call. It's a walk call. It's where you are with the Lord Jesus Christ. Danny Aiken, who's president of Southeastern, here's what he says. Southeastern Baptist Theological Seminary. Today there are more than 40 million problem drinkers in America. Alcohol is the number one drug amongst teenagers. 1 in 3 American families suspects that 1 or more family members having a drinking problem. It's a big deal. I want you to think about it. Think about these concerns. In Mississippi, the blood alcohol concentration, you're going to be arrested if drinking in a car with a blood alcohol of 0.10. Most places is 0.08 DUI. 0.01, now check this out with you, 0.01 to 0.05%. Here's the effects of it. Some, the great loss of judgment and coordination. Your thinking is dulled. Your changes in mood and behavior are significant. If someone who is 129 pounds or less takes 1 12-ounce beer, 1 4-ounce shot of wine, or 1/4 ounce of 80-proof liquor, will have that 0.05% to that 0.08% of blood alcohol level. It's significant. What are the effects of that? Walking, speech, hand movements are clumsy, blurred, split, or tunnel vision may occur. Chance of accident is increased by 300% or more. Think about it. So you think about Proverbs 23, birthday, and you look at 29. Who has woe? Who has sorrow? Who has contentions? Who has a strife? Who has a complaining? He goes down to verse 20 and 35, and he says, "They struck me, but I didn't know it. I didn't hurt. They beat me, but I didn't know it." Those kinds of things. Verse 32, Mary, about the viper and the serpent. James Merritt said it's impossible. This is what he says. It's impossible to be bitten by a snake that you never played with. Think about that. That verse 32 right there makes a statement. At the end, it bites like a serpent, it stings, or it poisons like a viper. And Merritt says it's impossible to be bitten by a snake. It's pretty significant there. Dr. Adrian Rogers, he's in heaven today. Listen to what he says. Alcohol has brought this to a world, unparalleled suffering. As a counselor, I know that alcohol will cause a man to lie to his mother. It will cause a man to beat his wife. It will cause a man to deprive his children. It will cause an otherwise virtuous woman to forget her marriage vows. It will turn obedient children into rebuking against their parents and against society. And against God. Significant right there. When you begin to think about that and you begin to break it down. Look at Proverbs 23:29 again. I want to show you something. As the writer of Proverbs, when Solomon wrote this, he said, "Who has woe? Who has sorrow?" Think about it. The woe and the sorrow, dealing with the emotional problems, dealing with the issues there, the effects of alcohol on your life. Who has woe? Who has sorrow? Who has contention? The emotional problems. Look what it comes down to there. The contentions and the complaining. The social problems. We always want to blame somebody else. We want to put it off on somebody else. The social issues that go along with that. And then it comes down with the wounds of red eyes, the redness of eyes, bloodshot eyes, the physical problems. All of that coming from exposing ourselves to what we know as alcohol. So there's a battle going on. There's a battle going on for lives, and it starts at a young age. Talking to more and more kids today, listen, we're finding out that those that are 9 and 10 years old are being exposed more and more to alcohol in a negative kind of way and drugs and those kinds of things. I'm telling you, it's affecting their lives. And so you and I in America need to wake up and smell the roses when it comes to that. It's significant in the battle of what goes on at a young age because that reverts. You think about it in this building this morning, what age you started and where it got to and where you are today as a result of what that did in your life, but thank God Jesus moved on your life, right? Thank God Jesus came in your life. He changed your life, and you are where today as a result of the change that the Lord Jesus brought. So the fact is, the battle to drink. Let's talk about the beverage. We'll give you some more stats as we move along with this morning. The beverage that's being taken. Yale University. They did a great study on alcoholism. Listen to it. It was revealed through their study that the normal process, and this is where we get into it. I had in that conversation this past weekend, if I told you who it was, some of you know it, so I'm not going to do it. But the thing is, he said, look, here's the deal. Jesus drank wine, and Jesus drank in the Bible. So I don't see any problem with people drinking today. I want you to listen as a preface to this. It was revealed that the normal process of fermentation, the fruit of the vine, does not produce a drink with sufficient alcohol content to bring on drunkenness. This is Yale, secular. There must be a mechanical interference with the normal process, such as the addition of pure alcohol or other mechanical processes of distillation, or it will not produce the kind of wine that is common today. The Hebrews would have referred to this, our wine, our beer, as strong drink, which the Bible condemns. So when you begin to think about it and you look at the Lord Jesus and you look at where he was, even though people say, well, he drank, why can't I? I don't think Jesus was in the liquor business. Man. And so, when you begin to look at that, I don't think we're dealing apples for apples. A scholar, New Testament scholar, Robert Stein, he did some research in his own in wine drinking in the ancient world. This goes all the way back to some Jewish sources and use the Bible. And he made a fascinating discovery about the wine that's talked about in the Bible and compared to the wine today. And here's what he said. The wine of biblical times was not like the wine that exists today. Stein's research uncovered the fact that wine in the days of Jesus, for example, was actually wine was mixed with water. On average, it would be several parts of water to one part of wine. In other words, what the Bible calls wine was purified water in a lot of ways, he says. He points out that water in the ancient world was unsafe to drink, and it had to be boiled, filtered, or you could put some wine into it to kill the germs. The problem today is the alcohol content. By the way, concentrated alcohol was only known in the Middle Ages when the Arabs invented the distillation. So what is now called liquor or strong drink and the 20% fortified wines of today were unknown in biblical times. Dr. Stein noted that one would have to drink, 22 glasses of wine, he estimates, in order to consume the alcohol in 2 martinis. Think about that, the significance of that. In summary, he closes it out. He said, though fermented wine was drunk in biblical times, and though the Bible approves of the wine drinking, one needs to remember that the alcohol content of ancient wine was much less than the wine of today. What is consumed today is not the wine of the New Testament. To equate the two would be like comparing apples and oranges. And Dr. Norman Geisler went on to do some other research. He says, therefore, Christians ought not to drink wine, beer, or other alcoholic beverages, for they are considered strong drink and are forbidden in Scripture. He said, even the ancient pagans did not drink what some Christians drink today. Think about it. Today's alcoholic beverages, when you begin to look at strong wine, strong drink, however you interpret it, that should be condemned, should be stayed away from as the Christian thought. Let me give you a few more of the thoughts, and then we're going to move on and wrap it up here just a little bit. When the Bible uses wine, I want you to know and understand this morning, it may be fermented, it may be unfermented, or it may be diluted with water. And when we look at the process of today's distilled liquor, adding the alcohol to the beverages, that had not been invented at the time of the biblical time. So we cannot really compare the Bible's wine to today's wine or alcoholic beverages where the alcohol is added. In truth, much of what our culture calls wine, the Bible would call strong drink, which is forbidden for Christians. Today's alcoholic beverage should be avoided because of the Scriptures and what it says. Again, Danny Aiken, in his time, Jesus drank wine, and I'm sure that I would have, Danny says, if I lived in the first century. However, there's strong evidence that he never partook of a strong drink. It's possible to become intoxicated from wine mixed with 3 parts water. Did you hear what he said? It's possible to become intoxicated from wine mixed with 3 parts water. But here it is. One's drinking would probably affect your bladder before it would ever affect your mind. It should also be noted that children would drink this diluted mixture of water and wine. It seems clear that there's no one-to-one correspondence with first century and 21st century distilled liquor. Concerning the latter, I believe the Lord Jesus Christ would take no part. And so when you begin to think about this, it has a great impact. Romans 14:21 this morning. It is good not to eat meat or to drink wine or to do anything by which your brother stumbles or is offended or is made weak. Now, I want to tell you, we try to bypass, you know, I talked to you the other day about cutting the Scripture out, and somebody even told me they got the Bible back, and a certain amount of the Bible was gone. And the thing is, when you look at what Paul was saying, it's not good to eat meat or to drink wine or to do anything by which your brother stumbles or is offended or is made weak. When you think about it, and you begin to look at the history, you look at all the facts, when you begin to break it down, it is very clear that the first drink endangers many in alcoholism. I've had alcoholism in my own family. My uncle, my granddaddy got delivered, my granddaddy, from that. And you know, it happens. And the fact is that you and I need to understand that it's important not to expose our kids, even at a young age, to that. Research tells us that 1 out of every 7 people who drink become alcoholics. 1 out of 7. J.D. Greer says, we don't need to play around with a drink that has a solid chance of sabotaging and destroying my life or the life of someone I love. He goes on to say, 7 people follow my example. Listen to this. 1 out of 7, and using that research, if 7 people follow my example to drink socially because I do, and one of them becomes an alcoholic, J.D. Greer reminds us that God holds me responsible. Is that a chance that you or I are willing to take with our children? Are those that look up to us? Would Christian love really put others at this kind of risk? What a message coming out of the Bible study this morning. I mean, listen to this. Every year, 1,700 college students die of over drinking. That's four jumbo jet liners packed with college students. And then you think about that. What would be the implications be for the airline industry if that were to happen every year? That they would lose four jumbo jet liners every year. The same industry, the same jet liner, everything. The Dean of Students at Duke says this, that easily one-third of all discipline-related issues that comes through his office are alcohol-related. If you could eliminate one-third of the problem on your campus by changing one thing, would you not think solely about doing that sacrifice? I mean, it's significant when you begin to think about where we are. Going back to the writer Shakespeare, listen to what he says. Oh God, that men would put an enemy in their mouth to steal away their brains. Oh God, that men would put an enemy in their mouth to steal away their brains. If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves, seek my face, pray, turn. That's significant. By the way, how does Satan get to us first? Through your mind. He gets your mind, he gets your heart. He uses alcohol, he uses other mind-altering things that get to our minds. That's why we do stupid things when we're out of our mind. That's the power of the drink. That's the power of the beverage. But I'm telling you, the power of God is when he transforms your life. He transforms my life, and he takes it away. And he doesn't take just a little bit away. He'll take it all away. The problem is we don't want to give it to him. We want to hang on to it. And it's so significant in our life. And some people say, well, I've had people tell me, I'll never abuse alcohol. I'm not going to become alcoholic. Just one drink. One out of every 10. You willing to take that chance? One out of every 10 who take the drink will become an alcoholic. One out of every 10. I want you to listen to this. This is true right here. Noah Redlock this morning, not using me. But in a message like this, I want to make sure we get the facts. But I want you to think, because here's the deal. We talk about what it does to the mind and how Satan gets to our heart through our mind. We talk about guys, and I tell you this all the time, guys, Satan gets through our eyes and through our ears. He gets into our minds and then he gets into our heart. That's why it's so significant to stay away from it. Dangerous things like liquor and alcohol and things that damage our body and porn and all of those stuff. Listen to me. One man puts it this way. Wine is a deceiver. Alcohol causes compromise. Listen to this. We drink for happiness and become unhappy. Anybody ever had a hangover the next morning? We drink for joy. We became miserable. Wine is a deceiver. We drank for sociability, but we became argumentative. You ever seen somebody be perfect, go to drink, and want to fight? The alcohol. They find out they're not as big as they think they are. We drank for sophistication, and we became obnoxious. We drank for friendship, and we became enemies. Ever seen lives and marriages destroyed by alcohol? Relationships destroyed by alcohol? We drank for sleep and became awakened without rest. We drank for strength and felt weak. We drank for relaxation and got the shakes. We drank for bravery and became afraid. We drank for confidence and became doubtful. We drank to make conversation easier and we slurred our speech. We drank to feel heavenly and ended up feeling like we'd been to hell. That's about right. We drank to forget and were forever haunted. Ever known anybody? Anybody's family ever been affected by a drunk driver? Had a cousin. He's dead now, probably in hell. And he hit and killed a guy. He was drunk. Swerved. The guy was walking on the side of the road, killed him. Big deal. We drank for freedom and became a slave. We drank to ease problems and saw it multiply. We drank to cope with life, but what we really did was invited death. Well, that sounds like something I want to do. What about you? Anybody in this building want to take that list and say, man, I just want to bust it wide open? I don't know. It's the beverage is the battle. But let's talk about the test. What happens out of all of this? The best concerning, according to the Word of God. How do we deal with all of this? Pastor, you give us a lot of statistics this morning. How do we deal with it? First of all, I would ask you, I would submit to you, I would beg you today, don't drink, number one. Don't drink. Put an exclamation point there. If you struggle with it, call us. If you struggle with it, call us. If we would just learn to make the phone call, if we would learn just to reach out, you know, they want to refer to it as the finest of the brewer's art, or go for the gusto, or all of that kind of stuff, but they don't tell you what's going to happen in the end. They don't reveal what's going to happen. Vince Havner said this, I'm tired of hearing alcoholism called a disease. It's the only disease we're spending millions of dollars each year to spread. Think about it. And we're buying into that. We're buying into it. Somebody said what our generation does in moderation, the next does in excess. You know, I'm not going to do it this morning, but how many of us as children saw our dad or mom or our grandparents or somebody who was influential in our life drink, and we begin to drink to do drugs because they drink? Oh, it's innocent. They're little kids, and you're sitting there, what's those little kids doing? It's going to affect the next generation. Remember how we talked about that last week in sinful will, the life of sinning willfully, and how it's passed down from one generation to the next to the next. Man, the great evangelist Billy Sunday, he called liquor the devil in liquid form. Think about it. The devil in liquid form. Think about what's happened. Why? Because he's a great deceiver. Christians ought not to drink beer, ought not to drink wine, and the beverages that are associated with that. Listen to a former President George W. Bush. He quit drinking after his wife, Laura, had asked him a question. Here's what she said. She said, George, can you remember the last day you didn't have a drink? George, do you remember the last day you didn't have a drink? And he asked him this question. He asked himself this question. Could I continue to grow closer to God? Or was alcohol coming to my God? And he concluded, President George W. Bush, that if he continued in the way that he went, alcohol was becoming his God. And he laid it down and turned his life to the walk of God. See, what many don't realize is Spurgeon, one of our great theologians, Spurgeon was an alcoholic most of his life. But in his later years, he had a great conviction, and he changed. Now here's the deal. His two sons were against alcohol, and several students there in the college where he was. And the Lord used those and the Holy Spirit in 1871. That's when Spurgeon laid down alcohol. It became a total abstainer. And then he said, and he began to declare, next to the preaching of the gospel, the most necessary thing to be done in England is to induce our people to become abstainers. One of our greatest theologians. It's a word for us today. Where does it all come from, Pastor? How do we deal with this? I want to talk to you for just a moment as we wrap it up. Right at the closing. The whole thing about the moral deficiencies, the whole thing when we look at our country, when we look at our nation, when we look at the world, when you go back to the 2 Chronicles 7:14, we'll quote it. But I want to ask you, do you believe it? Because the real deal is that we ought to be living our life so that others can see Jesus in us. Therefore, we ought to be setting an example for others to follow. And if yours and ours is less than the example of the Lord Jesus Christ, then we got plenty of work to do. I don't want you to compare yourself to me. I don't want somebody else to compare themselves to you. But I want all of us to look at comparing ourselves to the Lord Jesus Christ. And then watching what the Lord Jesus will do and allowing Him to come through in our life. Live our life with integrity. Live our life with transparency. Live our life in a way that will glorify God. And anything less than God's best is called sin. It's called sin in the eyes of God. It's called sin in His Word. And you and I need to deal with that. We need to deal with it as individuals. We need to deal with it in accountability. We need to deal with it throughout our life. And so this morning, you may be in here and you say, Pastor, man, ain't never had this kind of problems. You know somebody who has. Somebody in this building is dealing with this right now. You've had urges. This week, either you participated or you had urges. And it may not be alcohol, maybe something else. But the fact is, you've had that, and you've allowed it to come into your life. You've allowed others to see it unveil in your life. Therefore, you have affected other people by the life in which you live. And if that person sees something in your life, and sees that, and then goes on following in your example, and then something happens to them that they turn, they fall away from God, they get killed, whatever, do you realize that that is on your life? You are responsible for that. So as we think about it, who is God going to hold accountable for our nation? Judgment begins where? At the house of God. People who proclaim Christianity, when you think about it, you can't blame anybody else but Christians. You've got to blame the people that have a chance to change, to do right under God, to follow the ways and the will of God. And so you and I need to understand this morning, we are called to a high standard. But we've taken it and we've reduced the standard down to what makes you feel good, what makes me feel good, or them people out there feel good. And so that's where you and I need to be called into accountability. When we think about that Galatians 5:13 passage, I don't know if Casey or Jim still have it, and bring it back up. For you who are called to freedom, brethren, do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love. Everybody say through love. Serve. Everybody say serve. One another. Love others as Jesus loves us. Pastor, it's not easy. I know it's not easy. Man, I'm telling you, we've had meeting and staff meeting and other people talking. I know why God gave me this banner, because 2016 is turning into one of the most warlike years, the battlesome years that we've experienced in a long time. We got a lot of families that are battling. We got a lot of individuals that are battling. We got a lot of things going on. And I'm telling you, part of it may be in alcoholism. It may be in some other deficiency in our life. And what you and I need to understand is that we need to strain, we need to press on, not for what we want, but we need to press on toward the goal to win the prize under Jesus Christ, under God, for which He has called us. And I'm telling you, if my people, God says, who are called by my name, will humble themselves, that means get it right, that they'll literally seek the face of God, that they will follow the Lord's will and do what God has called us to do. That we'll pray, literally dwell with God. Learn how to pray. Get beyond the God is great, God is good, small prayers that we need to start our kids with. Begin to grow, begin to mature, and get in deep with God and see what God wants to do. And then dwell with Him, listen to Him, humble myself, pray, seek the face of God, turn from the wicked ways. God says He's going to hear. God says He's going to heal. God does not lie, but you and I have to get it right first. It's contentious. On our actions. And it is in our life, guys. It is in our life, ladies. That is significant. And people say, well, alcohol didn't hurt anything. Come on, take a ride with me. Let's go down to the inner cities. I don't even have to go to the inner cities. Let's just ride down. If you haven't been down to the park on Chico, just go take a look. It might be that you could go to your next door neighbor's house. It might be you could go to your house. I don't know. But come on and just take a ride on the journey God has for us. Guys, He's got so much more in store. Don't sell yourself short. Don't expose your children to it. Those of you, I'm not going to look down. I'm going to love your Bible through it. I'm just going to continue to preach the Word and try to teach you. As God teaches me, as people speak into my life. And we got some hot button issues. Some of you are dealing with some hot button issues, but it comes down to us, guys. Girls, it comes down to us. You got to want it. You got to put your life under Jesus. And there's no halfway. Either you are or you're not. Either it is Jesus or it's not. One or the other. And so we've got to call it what it is. And we've got to deal with it. Okay, I didn't want to ask you to just come again.